Simon Townsend's Wonderworld, episode number 331/5, pin number XC9629, recorded the 18/3/86 for transmission on the 11/4/86, Melbourne, Adelaide, Sydney and Brisbane. A little bit of difficulty here because Woodrow wants the sausages and he's frightened poor old Winston up into the rafters of the studio. But anyway, hello and welcome to my Wonder World. The first story today is about sausages. That's why I've got some to show you. A sausage is chopped meat. It's also a bit of seasoning and it's all encased in a little thin skin. And then you've got your sausage. I'll bet you didn't know that there are two main types of sausages, Woodrow. There's one called the wet sausage and there's something called the dry sausage. But how are they made? I'm busy, so I'll let reporter Brent Clements tell you more.
How do you make a sausage you can eat, boys? There's lots of things to do and more to see. So step inside and we will show you how it's done.
Small fry, dancing for a penny.
The art of making a sausage starts right here with the ingredients. And today we're making minted lamb sausages. So naturally, mint and lamb are the main ingredients. But to that we add special secret spices and herbs. And all of this goes into a mincer and it's minced up for about 5 to 10 minutes.
After it's been minced and strained out into a tub below, the herbs and spices are added and the whole process repeated. The end result is a very fine mix which is ready to be put through one of two machines.
There's 45 kilograms of sausage mix in this big vat, which is called a filler. And using air pressure, it's going to fire this mix out through that nozzle there into an intestine. And then someone else ties it or links it off by hand. Now, every now and then, this wonderful little contraption here is known to hiccup, explode, and throw 45 kilograms of meat over everybody in the immediate vicinity. You know what's on the inside of a sausage, but what's on the outside of a sausage? Well, it's called a casing, and there are two types of casing. There's the natural casing, which is made out of animal intestine, gizzards or guts. And that's pig intestine there, and that's sheep intestine there. And there's also the artificial casing, which is made out of a material called collagen. Yummy! Now this little number makes life a whole lot easier. It's an automatic filler linker. It fills the intestines full of meat and then links the sausages together. It has the capacity to churn out about 3 tons of meat an hour, the equivalent of about 3,000 sausages. You know, if you ask me, I reckon the whole process looks absolutely, totally and utterly repulsive. But what's even more fascinating is that you can actually adjust the size and weight of the sausages being fired out of that little nozzle there by twiddling these little knobs here. Now watch closely, because this is a once-only, never-ever-to-be-repeated offer. BC is going to make sausages. What you do is you slip your intestine onto the nozzle, being very careful to tie a knot at the end. Having done that, you bring the linker up like that, pull it back. When that's all firm and thin, you just hit the button down here with your knee. Well, I might not be able to make sausages, but this lady can, so watch closely. There are dozens of different varieties of sausages, but the ones we have available today are veggie bangers, weswurst, burwurst, bratwurst, beef and black bean, chicken and tarragon, garlic beef, country beef, beef and tomato, satay, Italian spicy, pork and apple, minted lamb, beef, lamb and parsley, beef curry and London pork. Excuse me, madam, what do you think of sausages?
I think they're absolutely delicious. They're my favourite food.
You just demolished my microphone.
Wonderful. Almost as disgusting as you. You really enjoyed that, didn't you? Yum. And Winston's rejoined us. He's come down from the rafters. After this break now, I'll have a record breaker and then a music clip and a film story on a very imaginative artist called Ken Doan. Smile, you'll use only 17 muscles. Frown, and you'll have to use 43. Michael Blattner is today's record breaker, and Michael writes to me and says, Simon, I'm a 12-year-old rugby union player. I play for New South Wales. Last year, my school team won the state championship. So Michael's a state rugby union champion. Good on you. A gift from me. This is the Guinness Book of Aircraft Facts and Feats. I'm sure you'll enjoy reading it. Some amazing pictures of some amazing aircraft in there. Now, some music, and this next music clip is really quite hysterical. It's called Clouds Across the Moon, and it's by the Ra Band. And it has the most spectacular telephonist who's dressed in space-age gear and is, in fact, a little bit like a robot. And the amazing thing is he breakdances as he makes the telephone connections. And it's about this girl, I guess, on Earth who rings her husband, actually on Mars, and she talks to him about mundane things like his cold and the weather and the fact that his kids love him. And I think it's just crazy.
Good evening. This is the intergalactic operator. Can I help you?
Yes. I'm trying to reach Flight Commander P.R. Johnson on Mars, flight 247.
Very well. Hold on, please. You're through.
Thank you, operator.
Hi, darling. How you doing? Hey, baby. Were you sleeping? Oh, I'm sorry, but I've been really missing you. Hi, darling. How's the weather? Say, baby, is that cold better now? Oh, I'm sorry. Is there someone there with you? Oh, since you went away, there's nothing going right. I just can't sleep alone at night. I'm not ashamed. On the phone, but I just stay right here at home. I don't think that I can take it anymore. We'll be right back.
valuable deep space communication link. Please be as brief as possible. Thank you.
Oh, since you went away, there's nothing going right. I just can't sleep alone at night. I'm not ashamed to say I badly need a friend. Or the connection. Could you try again, please?
I'm sorry, but I'm afraid we have lost contact with Mars 247 at this time.
I like it. It's unusual, isn't it? Here, have a seed. Some artists are very good and very talented, and yet they don't make all that much money during their lifetime. Often these artists' paintings become very valuable after they're dead. Well, one artist who's clever and talented is making a lot of money because he markets his art very well. His name is Ken Doane, and the reporter on this story is Hugh Munro.
Ken has entered into the Archibald Prize four times. That's a contest for portrait painting. Portraits are usually called self-portraits, but he's called it me, because it's a picture of him, and he sees himself with two faces. Also, the Harbour Bridge is always on his mind, so that's where he put it. What's your particular style of painting called?
Well, there's no one style. I have different kinds of styles depending on what I'm doing. If it's a T-shirt, it's one feeling. If it's a painting, it's something else.
Ken's portraits just aren't pictures of people. He tells a story about them as well. This is Olaf Ruin, who's a famous Australian author. I see Olaf like a rock, strong and of the sea. He's a very good writer and a very nice man. I've never seen him without a book in his hand. Your influences are Picasso and Matisse.
Well, anybody that likes colour as much as I do certainly have been influenced by those two artists, but there are lots of artists whose work I admire. They're probably the best known ones.
His art seems to end up on just about everything. Placemats, coasters, hats, tea towels, shirts. How did your art become so popular?
Well, for the very first exhibition that I had of painting, when I was 40, I made some very simple drawings of Sydney Harbour and put them on a dozen T-shirts to give to a few friends that were coming, and more people were interested in them, so I made more and more of them.
There are six different colours in most of the T-shirts, and they're printed right here on this carousel. This machine dries and cures the ink so that it won't wash out. They make about 1,000 of these a day. The drawing then becomes the painting.
You do your work so quickly. Why do they cost so much?
Well, some of it I do quickly, and certain things, I suppose it's just like a singer or it's just like a musician. You might only be on stage for a while, but what you're really paying for, I suppose, is the amount of years that that person's put into developing their abilities.
These will be antiques, so if you've got anything by Ken Doane, don't throw it away, because one day it could be worth a fortune.
Ken Doane, amazing artist. Coming up, a story on the inaugural cherry seed spitting competition in Young. I was there, in fact. In fact, I launched the competition. More than 1 million Earths would fit inside the sun. some carpets from Iran are woven from camel hair. Goodness gracious. The Guinness Book of Records is full of the most ridiculous records published under the headings of things like apple peeling and scratching your head and bed making. They've got custard pie throwing in Guinness, haggis hurling, and even hair splitting, all sorts of things like that. And now we have something called cherry seed spitting. Australia's first cherry seed spitting championships took place in Young in New South Wales, and Wonderworld was there to record it. Your reporter, Wednesday Kennedy.
I'd just like to say thank you very much for welcoming me to your city of Young, and I'm really pleased to be here for the cherry seed spitting competition.
Well, Lord's the inaugural Australian cherry seed spitting competition, and Simon's about to let go with the first.
He's got to get far.
Cherry Festival start?
It started in 1949, first as a cherry blossom festival, and they used to hold it in September, but people thought in later years it'd be better to have it while the fruit was on, and I think it's a much better time because people can come and actually eat the cherries, and that's what it's all about.
And why did it start as a cherry spitting festival?
I think our organising committee was so good that they thought up that we had to have some gimmick, and it's proved us worth it.
What does it take to be a good cherry spitter?
A long tongue. Oh, I just got to have practice.
Big mouth.
Now, there's a definite art to spitting cherries. First of all, you take your cherry, put it in your mouth, roll it round, chew it out till that's all you've got left, and a big gust of wind blow. 8 metres, 970 millimetres was a record spit, and the record spit was done by Jason Anderson. How do you feel?
Rather good.
This is Ben Taylor, the winner of the high school section of the cherry spitting competition. How did you do it, Ben?
Just straightforward aerodynamics and a bit of a tailwind at the time. Not bad. A lot of self-training and hard discipline by my mother at home. This is to use out there.
This is Kevin Burnell, who shattered Australia's record for cherry spitting. What was the last record, Bob?
Well, the world record itself, 19.8, held by Rick Krause in Michigan. It was done about 1980, but this is a great day for Australia because we haven't had such a performance here before. 13.36 metres.
What's your style of spit?
I don't know. I've never done it before.
Will you have a spit for us so we can have a look?
Are you kidding? Oh, anything for a bit of fun.
Cherry seed spitting competition. That was a great day in Young. Really loved it. And now it's time for a report from one of you out there. It's time to meet a newshound. Today's newshound is James Brown, and he reports to me, "Simon, I spent my last holiday in Queensland aquaplaning. It was great fun. I was lucky I didn't fall in once because the water was very, very cold." And here's something from me to you, James. This is a thing called a stomper toy. It comes from Krona. This battery-operated water demon and trailer set moves. Don't chew the prizes, please. moves on water, or it moves on land, and it's even got special flotation tyres. And here's another gift from me to you. This is a door chime. It's from Arlec, an electronic door chime, and once you've got wired up to your front door, you'll have a ding-dong door chime, and it even has a special adjuster at the back to control the tone of the chime. Doesn't it, mate? Tastes good too. And here's something else. This is from Weirdo's Magic Shop. It's a very weird hat, and it says, "I'm their leader, which way did they go?" And you can wear it any way you like. You can wear it like that. Right after a short break, we'll be back and we'll have a story on a bike shop on Lord Howe Island. It's an important bike shop because the bicycle is the main form of transport on the island. Right, Winston?
Simon loves to reply to your letters, but remember you must also send a second envelope. And this second envelope must have your name and your address on it. And it must have another stamp on it too, if you want your photo returned by Simon.
That a diamond will not dissolve in acid. The only thing that can destroy it is intense heat. Amazing. When reporter Edith Bliss was on Lord Howe Island, she knew that the best way to see the lovely Lord Howe Island was to take a leisurely trip on a bicycle. She went to a shop where the couple who own it are also willing to give lessons on how to ride a bike. Lessons? But everyone knows how to ride a bike, don't they? Don't they, Edith?
Someone up there likes me. They hire push bikes here. I think I'll go and spoke to the big wheel about a bike.
What's the matter?
Oh.
You look exhausted.
Oh, that's the matter. I'll have to hire a bike. I can't walk anymore.
Right, no problem. You used to riding or not?
There is a problem. I can't ride a bike. Maybe if I have a little baby one, a really tiny bike, I must be able to manage that. I can keep my feet on the ground and just...
Now, if we have one so that you can straighten your legs out, it'll be much easier.
Are you sure?
Well, you don't have to get on like a horse. You put your foot through there.
I told you I couldn't
ride.
Yeah,
okay, righto. Now, I'm going to hold you so there's nothing to worry about. Put your foot on your high one and push off hard. Look straight ahead where you're going. Don't look down.
I have to watch that it doesn't wobble.
No, don't worry about that. Just look up where you're going and push nice and hard to get started.
You ready for this?
Yeah, I'm ready. Where you go. Come on.
Here we go. Beth's got around about 160 bikes available for hire, so amongst that number, there's got to be one that's the right size for you. For example, she's got bikes that are small enough for a little four-year-old to ride. There's your standard ladies' bike, which doesn't have the bar across the middle there. And then, of course, your standard adult bike, usually ridden by the men, because it's got the bar across the middle there.
You look so pretty as you were riding along.
I can't believe how cheap it is to hire a bike. I wish I'd thought of this in the first place. It's $2 for a day's hire. Now, a day is 24 hours long here, so I don't have to bring it back till the same time tomorrow. And as well, I got all of those lessons. Do you see how well I was riding? I can't wait to get out on the road and practice.
You look so pretty as you were singing this song.
I'm certainly glad I met up with a few of the Lord Howe locals because they've directed me to this quite historic spot. It's a war memorial which was erected to remember the men who served in both of the World Wars who came from Lord Howe Island. But if you ask me, I think the guy's favourite part of this is the fact that there's an old machine gun which was captured in 1918, and I think that's why they like coming here, so they can play with it. Is that right?
Yeah.
I can really understand why they like having push bikes on Lord Howe Island, because it keeps the peace, it stops air pollution, and of course the noise pollution, which gives us our peace.
A bit of a super bike. That's the show for today. It's a lovely place, Lord Howe Island. We've got to go, don't we, guys? You're falling asleep already. We'll see you on Monday. Thanks very much for watching the show. And always remember, keep remembering the whole of this weekend. The world really is wonderful.
What do you get when you cross a kangaroo and a sheep?
What do you get when you cross a kangaroo and a sheep?
A woolly jumper.